Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. My name is Aaron. I'm a junior doctor working in London, and on the side I put out some medical education content onto YouTube, Instagram and Twitter, which I found helpful when I was studying, and hopefully it's of some use to you guys. So in my last video I talked about the retrospective approach to preparing for OSCEs, which is where you use a case-based approach to preparing for your OSCEs in three steps. Number one, by formulating an OSCE cases list of the most likely cases that come up. Number two, by preparing your VIVA for each of those cases, so things like how you present those findings, the possible differentials. And then number three, finalizing your examination routine into a table with three columns, the step of the routine on the far left, what signs to specifically look for in the middle column, which we already know from our VIVA prep, and then the far right-hand column, what exactly we're going to say to the patient and the examiner throughout our examination routine. If you haven't watched it, then please do give it a watch if you have a spare 8 minutes. Honestly, I think using this approach was the biggest factor in helping my friends and I when we were preparing for our finals in Cambridge. So hopefully you find it useful. Now in this video, I'm gonna go through the four most common cases that could come up in your cardiology OSCE. We'll go through the first case in full, right from recognizing the findings, being able to put these into a clear presentation format, and then answering some typical VIVA questions. And then for the remaining cases, we'll focus purely on what examination findings to expect and then how we can present them clearly. As usual, everything will be timestamped in the description below and in the pinned comments, so feel free to jump to any particular part. So onto the first case, we're going through our cardiology examination routine and we know exactly what signs to look for by using the retrospective approach. And this is what we find. So there's no positive findings peripherally. And then moving on to the chest, on auscultation, we find what we think is an ejection systolic murmur, heard loudest over the aortic region, augmented on held expiration with the patient sitting forward, and then there's radiation to the carotids. So this is a case of aortic stenosis. And the best way to try and remember the sound of aortic stenosis is that you hear S1, then there's a very, very tiny gap, followed by a crescendo, and then a decrescendo. And that's a murmur of aortic stenosis. And it sounds something like this. And in terms of the theory behind why aortic stenosis sounds like this, if we start with a basic diagram of the heart, so here we have the right atrium and the left atrium with the vena cava and the pulmonary vein bringing blood towards the heart, and then here we have the right ventricle and the left ventricle with the pulmonary artery and the aorta taking blood away from the heart, and here we have the valve, so on the right hand side we have our tricuspid valve and our pulmonary valve, and on the left side we have our mitral valve and our aortic valves. So if we focus just on the left side for now, the S1 sound comes when the mitral valve closes. So it's a mitral valve closing that gives us the S1 sound. Now when the mitral valve closes, the left ventricle begins to contract. And at this point, the aortic valve is still closed. And then as the left ventricle begins to contract stronger and stronger, the pressure inside the left ventricle increases and it forces that aortic valve open. And in aortic stenosis, the problem is that the valve doesn't open completely. Stenosis just means narrowed, so I guess the valve opening is narrowed. So you hear an ejection click as the valve suddenly stops at the stenotic position. So now that the aortic valve is open, the left ventricle starts to contract harder and harder, the pressure inside the left ventricle goes higher and higher, and more blood passes through the aortic valve. And that's why you get that crescendo as the first part of the murmur. Then as the left ventricle begins to relax, less and less blood passes through the aortic valve, and you get the decrescendo part of the murmur. So that's why aortic stenosis presents with this ejection systolic murmur. So now let's have a look back at this case and the positive findings. So the most common question we get asked after we've finished our examination routine is to present our findings. And we're gonna use that simple structure where we start with an introductory sentence where we try to commit to one particular diagnosis if we have an idea. Then we state our positive findings, then any relevant negative findings, and then finally that summary sentence. So using this structure, this is how we would present this case of aortic stenosis. I performed a cardiovascular examination on this patient who has signs suggestive of aortic stenosis. My main positive findings are, on auscultation, I could hear normal first and second heart sounds with a systolic murmur between S1 and S2. The systolic murmur was an ejection systolic murmur, heard loudest over the aortic region, and augmented on held expiration with the patient sitting forward with radiation to the carotids. My relevant negative findings are that there are no signs of vascular risk factors such as nicotine staining or tendon xanthomata. There are no peripheral stigmata of infective endocarditis. There are no scars to suggest coronary artery bypass graft or valve replacement. and there are no signs of decompensation such as pulmonary or peripheral edema. This points towards a diagnosis of grade 3 aortic stenosis with no evidence of decompensation. And grade 3 is just to add a bit of spice, and we'll come on to grading of murmurs in a bit. So the most likely follow-up question to something like that would be, what are your differentials? And I think it's absolutely fine to just list 3 or 4 differential diagnoses. But just to be even more impressive, I think it's nice to just drop in a line about why some of those are lower down your list. So for example, in this case, you could say something like, my number one differential would be aortic stenosis, given the signs that I've found. I would also like to consider something like aortic sclerosis, and this is where the aortic valve leaflets are thickened. I'd also expect an ejection systolic murmur here, but no radiation to the carotids because there's no outflow obstruction. Another differential would be mitral regurgitation, although this would more likely present with a pansystolic murmur, loudest over the mitral region. Next, you could get asked about the complications of aortic stenosis. And as with any question in medicine, it's always better to give a clear, structured answer than to list out things without thinking logically. And a good way to try and give some structure is to classify things. So for example, here you could classify into complications from the valve, such as infective endocarditis, embolic disease, such as a stroke from a disintegrating calcific valve, as well as hemolytic anemia, such as when the red blood cells get damaged as they pass through the valve. Or you could say you could get complications from the outflow obstruction, such as left ventricular failure. And then your examiner could ask you, how would you investigate this patient? And once again, try and classify your investigations. So one way is bedside tests, blood tests, imaging, and special tests. And with investigations, try and mention why you're doing that particular test and why it's relevant. So in this case, I'd like to investigate this patient by starting with some bedside tests. So by checking their heart rate and blood pressure to check that this patient is hemodynamically stable. I'd then like a urine dipstick to look for proteinuria, which would suggest infective endocarditis. That's one of the complications we mentioned earlier. And then also check for glycosuria, which would suggest diabetes, one of those vascular risk factors we mentioned in our presentation. I'd also like to do an ECG to look for signs of left ventricular strain, such as left bundle branch block. Moving on to blood tests, I'd like to do an FBC to look for signs of hemolytic anemia, and then inflammatory markers to look for signs of infective endocarditis. I'd then move on to imaging, so I'd want to start with a chest X-ray to look for signs of calcification of the aortic valve, and also signs of pulmonary edema, such as curly B lines and cardiomegaly. And then my gold standard test, which would be an echocardiogram, which would allow me to both diagnose and assess the severity of the aortic stenosis. And signs of severe aortic stenosis would include a valve area of less than 1 cm² and a pressure gradient of more than 40 millimeters mercury. And finally, special tests I like to do would be coronary angiography to assess the coronary circulation, as someone with aortic stenosis is likely to also have some element of coronary artery disease. You definitely don't have to mention all of those tests and investigations, and nor will you have time to, but it's more important to try and classify them, and if you do mention a test, explain why it's relevant to your diagnosis. Now, just on the last bit of grading murmurs, if you remember from the presentation, I graded this as grade 3 aortic stenosis. So officially, all heart murmurs are graded according to the Freeman and Levine grading system. It goes from grade 1 to grade 6. Grade 1 is the faintest of faint murmurs. Grade 2 is a faint murmur. Grade 3 is technically a loud murmur without a thrill. Grade 4 is a loud murmur with a thrill. Grade 5 is when the murmur is heard with the stethoscope only partially on the chest. And grade 6 is when you can hear the murmur with the stethoscope completely off the chest. So basically, grade 5 and grade 6 are super rare. They're the patients who really need an urgent valve replacement, so they're unlikely to be in your OSCEs. Grade 1 and grade 2, I think, are literally for cardiology consultants only to be able to listen to. So if you hear a murmur, you can be pretty safe that it's grade 3 or grade 4, and it's easy to distinguish which one. If there's a thrill there, then it's grade 4, and if there isn't, it's grade 3. And a thrill is just where you feel over where the murmur is loudest, and you feel a palpable vibration, which is actually the turbulent blood flow. Okay, so that's the end of the first case. Hopefully that gives you some sort of framework in terms of presenting your findings, and also how to answer your VIVA questions systematically and also clearly. So if we have a look at the positive findings in this case, peripherally we've found that there's an irregular pulse. And then moving on to the chest, on auscultation we found a pansystolic murmur, heard loudest over the mitral region, augmented on held expiration with the patient lying on their left side, and there's radiation to the axilla. So these findings are classic for mitral regurgitation. So a pansystolic murmur is a murmur that lasts all the way from S1 to S2, and it doesn't change in its intensity, unlike aortic stenosis, where we have the crescendo and then the decrescendo. Now, if we think about how the irregularly irregular pulse is linked to the mitral regurg. So if we go back to my basic diagram of the heart, the problem in mitral valve regurgitation is that the mitral valve doesn't close properly. So when we have our left ventricle contracting, and remember, this is the strongest muscle in the heart that pumps blood all around the body, some of that blood is regurgitated from the left ventricle back into the left atrium. And after many, many years of this, the left atrium starts to remodel, it becomes dilated, and it doesn't contract as smoothly. And this affects the electrical conduction through the heart. So rather than having a regular pulse, you end up with atrial fibrillation, where you have an irregularly irregular pulse. So now let's have a look at how we would present our examination findings. I performed a cardiovascular examination on this patient who has signs suggestive of mitral regurgitation. My main positive findings are I could feel an irregularly irregular pulse suggestive of atrial fibrillation, and on auscultation I could hear normal first and second heart sounds with a systolic murmur between S1 and S2. The systolic murmur was a pansystolic murmur, heard loudest over the mitral region, augmented on held expiration with the patient lying on their left side with radiation to the axilla. My relevant negative findings are there are no signs of vascular risk factors such as nicotine staining or tendon xanthomata. There are no peripheral stigmata of infective endocarditis. There are no scars to suggest coronary artery bypass graft or valve replacement. And there are no signs of decompensation such as pulmonary or peripheral edema. So this points towards a diagnosis of grade 3 mitral regurgitation complicated by atrial fibrillation. So as you can see from that, a lot of the time you can reuse the relevant negatives for almost any cardiology case. And the VIVA questions for this would be similar to before. So what are your differential diagnoses? What are the possible complications of mitral regurg? And maybe how would you investigate this patient? So now on to the next case. So if we have a look at the positive findings here, we can see that this patient has lots of bruising on their arms. And there are lots of patients with bruising, but you'll see that in this case, it's very relevant. So make sure you mention it if you see it along your examination routine. And then centrally, we can see we've got a midline sternotomy scar. From the end of the bed, we can hear a clicking noise. And then on auscultation of the chest, we can hear a metallic second heart sound with what we think is an ejection systolic murmur, but it doesn't radiate to the carotids. So these findings are typical of a metallic prosthetic aortic valve. So let's have a look at the thinking behind going from these signs to this diagnosis. So we have a midline sternotomy scar with no associated graft scars on the arm or leg, which would suggest a coronary artery bypass. Just because there isn't a graft scar that we can see, we can't rule out a CABG, because some patients have internal mammary harvests where rather than taking the vessel from the arm or leg, they take it from the chest. I think some surgeons prefer this approach because there's some evidence that the internal mammary artery doesn't narrow over the time as much as the vessels from the arm or the leg. However, in this case, that clicking sound that we can hear from the end of the bed gives it away that this patient has a prosthetic valve. And not only a prosthetic valve, we can tell that it's a metallic prosthetic valve. So broadly speaking, there are two types of prosthetic valves. You've got the metallics and then the bioprosthetics, usually from a pig. And then when we listen to the chest, we can hear that metallic heart sound in S2, which tells us that it's a metallic aortic valve. Instead, we'd hear a metallic S1 for a metallic mitral valve. There's also an ejection systolic murmur that we can hear in this case, and that might have thrown a few of you. I've put this in as it's not that rare to hear this kind of murmur with a prosthetic valve. And what this is a flow murmur, and this is because sometimes the prosthetic valve doesn't fit in perfectly. And it has the same features as an ejection systolic murmur, except it doesn't cause radiation to the carotids. So just be aware of that. We're almost there. The last positive sign to think about is the patient's bruising. And the reason why this is relevant is because patients with metallic prosthetic valves need to be on long-term anticoagulation, because there are increased risk of thromboembolic events like heart attacks and strokes. If you remember Virchow's triad, factors that increase your risk of a clot can be divided into endothelial factors, hypercoagulable factors, and hemostatic factors. Endothelial factors are things that affect the vessel wall, like hypertension. Hypercoagulable factors are things like pregnancy and cancer that make you more prone to clot by altering the balance between pro and anticoagulant factors. And finally, hemostatic factors are things to do with poor blood flow. So for example, a long surgery or prolonged immobility, for example, from a long haul flight. So by having a metallic prosthetic valve, the endothelial factors, so things like the interaction between the prosthetic valve and the suture zone, and the hemostatic factors from not having perfect blood flow through that valve are both shifted towards a more procoagulant state. And to counteract that, these patients are put on long-term anticoagulation such as warfarin or dabigatran, and they work on these factors to reduce your chance of producing a clot. And the side effect of this is that these patients have really fragile blood vessels at the surface of their skin, and they're really prone to bruising. So now that we understand why these signs are all relevant, let's see how we would present these findings. I performed a cardiovascular examination on this patient who has signs suggestive of an aortic valve replacement. My main positive findings are a midline sternotomy scar with no associated graft scars on the arms or legs, and then multiple bruises on the patient's arms. On auscultation, I could hear a metallic second heart sound consistent with a metallic prosthetic valve. I also heard an ejection systolic murmur, which was loudest over the aortic region and augmented on held expiration with the patient sitting forward. There was no radiation to the carotids. My relevant negative findings are there are no signs of vascular risk factors such as nicotine staining or tendon xanthomata. There are no peripheral stigmata of infective endocarditis, and there are no signs of decompensation such as pulmonary or peripheral edema. This points towards a metallic prosthetic aortic valve with a flow murmur. The valve seems to be functioning well with no signs of complications such as infective endocarditis. The bruising on the patient's arms is likely from long-term anticoagulant therapy. Okay, so that covers valve replacements. The only difference for a metallic mitral valve is you'd hear a metallic S1 rather than a metallic S2 that you hear in an aortic valve replacement. And the main questions to come up in a VIVA like this would be, what are the indications of a valve replacement? Why would you consider a bioprosthetic valve over a metallic valve? And what are the potential complications from a valve replacement? And potentially, what are the different subtypes of prosthetic valves? So for example, there are three types of metallic valves. You've got the ball and cage, the tilting disc, and the bileaflet. You can read up all about this on Wikipedia, or I'm trying to put all of my notes onto my website, and that should be up in a few weeks, so you can check it out there. So now on to the next case. Peripherally, we have finger prick marks from likely blood glucose monitoring and pitting edema up to about the level of the mid-shin. And centrally, we have a midline sternotomy scar with an associated graft scar on the right leg in the distribution of the great saphenous vein. And then we also have this scar along the neck, which you may not have seen before. So if we try and put these signs together, we have a midline sternotomy scar with the associated graft scar, which gives this way as a coronary artery bypass case. The great saphenous vein is commonly used because it's superficial, easy to access, and there's a redundancy of veins in the leg. But some patients will also have the graft scar on the arm where the radial artery can be used. The finger prick marks suggest this patient is likely diabetic, which is one of the vascular risk factors. The scar in this case in the neck is from a carotid endarterectomy, and this is a procedure done when the carotid vessel becomes very narrow, and you basically open up the carotid artery and remove the fatty plaques that are blocking it. And it's relevant here as this is a marker that this patient has carotid artery disease, which is another of the vascular risk factors. And the other sign we have here is pitting edema, which is a sign of decompensation. And this happens in heart failure because of abnormal starling forces, such as increased capillary pressure and decreased oncotic pressure, forcing fluid out of the vessels. So that's a theory. Now let's go on to how we would present this case. I performed a cardiovascular examination on this patient who has signs of a coronary artery bypass. My main positive findings are a midline sternotomy scar with an associated graft scar on the right leg, indicating a coronary artery bypass graft. I also noticed a vertical 7 centimeter scar on the neck along the distribution of the carotid artery, suggesting a likely carotid endarterectomy. There were finger prick marks from likely blood glucose monitoring and bilateral pitting edema up to the level of the mid-shin. My relevant negative findings are there are no signs of other vascular risk factors such as nicotine staining or tendon xanthomata. On auscultation, there were normal heart sounds with no added sounds or murmurs, and there were no peripheral stigmata of infective endocarditis. So this points towards coronary artery disease with a coronary artery bypass graft and a likely carotid endarterectomy. And the typical follow-up VIVA question would be things like, what are the risk factors of coronary artery disease? So things like smoking, obesity, hypertension, and try to classify these as modifiable risk factors and non-modifiable risk factors. Okay, so that was an overview of the 4 most common cardiology cases that could come up in your OSCEs. I hope you found that useful. If you did, please give this video a thumbs up, leave a comment if you want more of this kind of content, and please subscribe to the channel and click on that bell icon. For now, thanks for watching, have a good night, and I'll see you in the next video.